A hack attack.
Anything that is programmable is hackable.
And your secrets are at risk.
They're tracking everything that you do.
Hear what you need to do to protect yourself.
What you can do is not make yourself a target.
On today's 700 Club Interactive. Hi, I'm Andrew Knox. I periodically co-host this program. I used to be a sports reporter for the 700 Club, have a wife and three beautiful kids. And if you know more about me, chances are you're either family, friend, or Terry, I'm just another victim of identity theft.
Very possible. And Andrew wouldn't be alone. If you've shopped at Target or Home Depot or Staples or at dozens of other retailers, your data may have been compromised. In fact, with 15 million people as the victims of ID theft, it's the world's fastest growing crime. And here's the sad thing. We're making it pretty easy for the hackers. Watch this.
Okay, I don't usually do this, but here, I wanted to give you my number.
Oh, wow, I must say I'm flattered. Is this, this looks like a social security number.
Here. My credit card account and bank info. And my password is...
Shh.
Well, we can certainly joke about that, but there is a heavy element of truth there. Many people go to a coffee shop, a restaurant, or hotel and immediately search for the free Wi-Fi. And as Caitlin Burke reports, there are hackers nearby just waiting for them.
Think of the last time you surfed the web on public Wi-Fi while enjoying a cappuccino, eating a meal, or waiting for a plane. Now think of the information you entered, your password, credit card, maybe even your social security number.
Anytime you're using public Wi-Fi, chances are there's a hacker nearby with their own laptop trying to steal your information.
Anything that is programmable is hackable. Now, that being said, we live in a world where you can't just say, I'm going to forget the digital age, right? Just like you can't prevent crime, but what you can do is not make yourself a target.
Brian Kralis is vice president of SurMD, a company specializing in cybersecurity. He warns that if someone wants to steal your information, it's not hard to do.
You could literally take anybody who understands even a little bit about computers, and if they were to do a search on the internet, within 10 minutes, they could have an exact list, step by step, of how to hack a public Wi-Fi.
Armed with that information, we decided to see for ourselves by asking an ethical hacker to snoop on my computer in a coffee shop. I entered a fake username and password into a bank website, and within seconds, he had my information. My hacker, 22-year-old college student, Dallas Crilly.
So basically, I just set my computer over there, and I have a couple programs running that are essentially listening to everything that's going on the network. And one of them in particular is listening for things like usernames and passwords.
At age 12, Crilly's desire to beat a computer game led to an interest in hacking.
There was a game called Neopets. And I'm the type of person that wants to be the best at everything, and so I figure out the way to win at Neopets optimally would be to create programs that played the game for me. And so I started going on forums and talking to people who had no idea that I was 12, learning the tricks of the trade, and eventually I was making money in my sleep on Neopets writing these programs. And from there, some of these same people that I met online were hackers, and I started learning more and more about that.
He jokes that he uses his powers for good. At 14, he helped small businesses protect themselves from hackers, and now designing secure business websites.
The assumption that you're going to be safe is the biggest security hole in any network or any institution.
The most common stolen information, credit cards, usernames, passwords, and sensitive emails.
It can happen anywhere, and it doesn't take somebody sinister or somebody who looks like maybe they're a terrorist from another country hacking into your system. It's happening all over the place.
Something else to be aware of, the growing number of fake public Wi-Fi networks set up by hackers.
Cell phones can be many what we call Wi-Fi hotspots. And so somebody could be sitting here, they could be sitting in a Starbucks, wherever, and they could set up their network, but they can name it whatever they want. So if you're sitting in a Starbucks, they can name it Starbucks. If you're sitting here in Cache's, they can name it Cache's Wi-Fi. So now you're logging on to actually their Wi-Fi. And now, once again, they're tracking everything that you do.
Experts like Kralis and Krilli stress that the best way to keep your information safe is to assume that it's always at risk. Caitlin Burke, CBN News, Dallas, Texas.
Well, Caitlin's here with us now. Caitlin, this free Wi-Fi issue, a lot of people don't think twice about it. Right. It's just going to get more prevalent and worse, right?
Yeah, definitely. This is a huge problem. The Poneman Institute did a study last year. 47%, nearly half of all American adults have been hacked last year alone. So that's 12 months, nearly half of all U.S. American adults. And honestly, if you haven't been, I can't believe it hasn't happened to me. I'm in a Starbucks, and maybe I log on automatically even to the Starbucks Wi-Fi and then think, oh, let me check my bank account to make sure I have enough money for this cup of coffee. And you just hit the app, log on to your bank account, and you could easily become a victim.
Now, you talked about those frightening statistics, how many people have been victims. Do you always know right away if you are a victim?
No, you don't. A lot of the time, the most common way you find out is that maybe you're looking at your bank account and there are charges that you can't explain. Maybe it goes further than that and you actually get a call from a debt collector and you didn't incur that debt. So a lot of the times you don't really find out. Maybe you checked your credit score and you notice that it's not what it should be, but mm-mm.
What about protecting ourselves? Are there simple steps we can take?
There are. It seems like such common sense. You know, don't log on to your bank account using public Wi-Fi. Don't check your email using public Wi-Fi. I certainly wouldn't think about that. My phone buzzes, I pull it out, check my email, and easily can be hacked. As he mentioned in the story, I may think that I'm on Starbucks Wi-Fi and actually just be on a Wi-Fi that someone named themselves Starbucks so that they could hack me. And then also,
People don't think of that. You know, the innocent victim's not expecting those types of, right, of tricks to get people, but we gotta be aware of it.
Right. Another one, don't online shop while you're standing in line at somewhere like Starbucks on that Wi-Fi. You put in your banking information. And fourth, common sense, change your passwords. Yeah. You know, it's kind of a hassle sometimes. There are so many requirements. Make sure it's uppercase, make sure there's a number, change it every 6 weeks, but you really need to.
And certainly don't have the attitude of this will never happen to me or my family.
No, definitely. That's the most dangerous thing. That's what puts you most at risk.
Yeah. Very interesting. Good information. Thanks, Caitlin. And you can get more great tips on cbnnews.com. Let's go over to Terry.
Well, it's one thing to be proactive about protecting your identity now, but what can you do if you're dead? We'll tell you that story. It's next. ID thieves aren't just after your credit cards. They want your government and medical information as well. And as one Ohio woman recently discovered, it can even include stealing the identity of someone who has died. Heather Sells has that story.
While the family of Amy Reichheld mourned her death, the identity thieves got busy. Their strategy: simply spend $10 to purchase a copy of her death certificate.
Anyone can walk in and they don't, you know, keep track of it. I said, really? And they said, yes, it's public record.
A fact Reichheld found shocking.
Her death might be public record, but all that information you're handing out for $10 is not public record.
Most death certificates contain the full name of the deceased, their address, and their date of birth. In this case, the thieves targeted almost a dozen victims and walked away with tens of thousands of dollars.
The bad guy in this case went onto the obituary section in the local paper, realized that someone was deceased and that they could access their death certificate. Once they accessed that information on the death certificate, they went to the Postal Service, filed a change of address form, and actually got the mail diverted from the deceased individual to their residence.
Evan says the thieves were able to make changes on credit cards and drain bank accounts. The victims' families lost thousands, and in one case couldn't even pay for the funeral.
It's a very kind of devious and fairly smart way of stealing somebody's identity because they're not there to care. You know, Amy's not going to answer the phone and be like, "What? I didn't open this credit card. What are you talking about?"
Heather Sells, CBN News.
Well, postal inspectors have a few tips to avoid this kind of scam. First, notify credit bureaus right after the death of a loved one. Next, limit the personal details that are listed in an obituary. That doesn't seem very likely, does it? And finally, cancel your loved one's driver's license. Wow. Now, Jess, you had a situation a few years ago that you thought your identity was stolen. Tell us what happened.
Well, Andrew, Terry, it's actually not too long ago that it happened. And just like Caitlin said in her interview, I think the number one mistake we can make is believing that it's not going to happen to us. And that's exactly what I did. You know, you hear the stories, you think, oh, that's awful, that's terrible, but it'll never happen to me. Until you get a notification, which I did, that somebody may have purchased a house under my name.
A house!
And I thought, I never remember doing that. And it's probably one of the scariest feelings. It's that sinking feeling, oh no.
What you know, did you
do? So you have to go and open up an account and you have to follow the thing through. But fortunately, I was blessed in the fact that it was a fluke. I did not have a house opened in my name, but I would definitely adhere to some of the things that Caitlin has said, to the things, the advice that you have given. We can't make the mistake in thinking it's not going to happen to us.
Wow. Well, not only the stress it brings, but also the time that you spend trying to fix the problem. It's very time consuming.
And not only that, but the emotional energy. And then you're thinking, well, how does this affect my credit? You know, what if I do want to buy a house soon?
Yes.
You know, is this going to have long-term ramifications on my life, on my ability to have good credit history in the future?
Wow.
Well, I'm glad it worked out. It's all cleared.
It's all cleared.
All right, good. Well, coming up, you'll meet some people who are trying to protect their identities for very different reasons. You'll see why coming up next.
In many countries, you can be executed for believing in Jesus. Christians in those countries have to be cautious about sharing their faith. But last winter, George Thomas got exclusive access to a secret gathering of believers in a former Soviet republic. We have disguised their names and identity to protect their lives.
The setting could not have been more ideal.
This is a beautiful location. 70% of the country is mountainous. Locals call it the second Switzerland of Asia.
This is the mountains of Kyrgyzstan.
Our goal was to find a safe place away from the city to not draw attention of the authorities.
For a few days, Vitaly and a handful of Christians gathered in this secluded villa tucked away in the mountains, about a 2 hours drive outside the capital city, Bishkek.
We worship, pray, and strategize how to effectively share the love of Christ in our countries.
CBN News cannot show you their faces or reveal their real names for security reasons. In this room are secret believers from Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, and Tajikistan, all former Soviet republics in Central Asia, experiencing a rising tide of hostilities against believers. All are members of a Christian ministry that's reaching young people in the former Soviet Union.
It is practically impossible to openly share about Jesus Christ. Doing so will get you beaten, arrested, or killed.
Marat is a youth leader from Uzbekistan.
Last year was a difficult year for you.
Fortunately, I wasn't arrested, but I was repeatedly interrogated by secret police, accused of gathering people in my house. They said that what I was doing is illegal.
He runs an informal Christian school training Uzbek leaders.
The pressure is unrelenting. You can't relax. You're constantly under stress. You cannot trust anyone because you don't know if they'll turn you in or accuse you of proselytizing.
Daoud is from Kazakhstan, the largest of the five Central Asian countries. There were no Kazakh Christians back in 1990. Today, however, there are 15,000. But strict religion laws make it very difficult for churches to register.
According to our law, you cannot attend church until you are 18 years old. That means we cannot hold youth meetings, discipleship classes, or Bible study.
Feruz is from Tajikistan. This is home video of his secret house church smuggled out of the country and obtained exclusively by CBN News. The meetings are small and typically held in a believer's home.
The people in this video know exactly what's at stake. Our parents taught us from childhood that one day we may have to sacrifice our lives.
7 million people live in Tajikistan. 1,000 of them are Christian.
Each life counts. God says, be thankful every day, rejoice in every soul that comes into heaven. That's what keeps us going, one life at a time.
Religious freedom exists in all five countries under the constitution, but barely. While Islam is the dominant religion, a more radical expression is taking root in Central Asia. Dimitri Kabak is a human rights lawyer in Bishkek. He says fear of radicalism has led governments to adopt laws controlling all religions, including Islam and Christianity.
Groups from Saudi, Turkey, and elsewhere come in with a different interpretation and practice of Islam. That worries the authorities. Some of the radical groups have engaged in terrorist activities.
Oleg works in remote villages of Kyrgyzstan. He remembers what it was like spiritually soon after the fall of the Soviet Union.
There was a lot of freedom in the 90s. People could openly share the gospel. But eventually, Islam started to make a move and gain influence.
Up here in the mountains of Kyrgyzstan, the horse is another popular mode of transportation, especially to get around some of these tough terrains and these steep hills. You know, for the believers, this is a spiritual oasis because it's an opportunity to get away from the almost daily routine harassment and persecution from the authorities and to come together in a safe place, a beautiful place, and to get spiritually energized.
The beauty, the backdrop, the scenery, what a wonderful distraction from our daily challenges. To see Kyrgyz, Uzbek, Kazakh, and Tajik believers in the same place at one time is so encouraging. We draw strength from each other. We know we're not in this spiritual battle alone.
Encouraged, refreshed, and re-energized, the believers are back home now and uncertain of the days ahead. Yet they stand boldly convinced of a calling to make the name of Jesus Christ known, no matter the cost. George Thomas, CBN News, somewhere in the mountains of Kyrgyzstan.
You know, so many of these Stan countries that were a part of the USSR are not heard of very often, and we surely don't realize, I think, the great price of having faith in Christ in those places. We have such freedom here.
Yeah, Christians in this country are beginning to feel persecuted, and there certainly is more attack on the Christian believer, but certainly that puts it in perspective that we in this country of the United States need to be grateful for our freedoms and pray for those in other nations who are facing persecution.
Boy, that's the truth. I think how brave they are to even let our people come and shoot their faces, trusting that we won't reveal who they are or make a mistake with all of that. It's quite a thing. We need to be in prayer for these brothers and sisters in these areas of the world. We're going to be back with more Interactive right after this, so stay with us.
Well, right now I want you to meet two of Superbook's biggest fans. Jack and Kate look forward to every new episode of the cartoon series, and so do their grandparents. Here's why.
Jack and Kate love Superbook. Their new favorite is Revelation, the final battle.
Like in the future, whenever the final battle begins and whenever Satan will be taken away, it's whenever all sin will be gone, sickness, death, it will all be gone, and the people that believe in Jesus will get to go to heaven.
My favorite scene is when Jesus and all the angels are come to attack the devil and all his army.
Out of all of the Superbook DVD stories, the character Jack really loves is Gizmo.
He's just really funny, and he's a robot, and he can do crazy stuff, like make a force field and fly around. It's really cool.
Every month, Jack and Kate get a new episode from their grandparents, Ronnie and Jody Walker. They signed up for the Superbook Club when they saw it was a great way to teach their grandchildren about the Bible. But it
will be the animation is so top quality. I love it. The fact that the Word of God is going out through the stories, it's a great way for them to catch the Word of God.
Their mom, Stephanie, loves to see Jack and Kate learn truths about God in a way they can understand and enjoy.
Do not be afraid. I will never leave you or forsake you.
I do like that both of my kids are very educated when it comes to the Bible now, and they enjoy the stories, but they're learning and they can repeat scripture back to me.
The Superbook has changed my life of how to be kind to people and how to every night just go and pray to Him.
The end of every Superbook gives kids an opportunity to accept Jesus as their Savior through a salvation song Kate knows by heart.
Forgive me now of all my sin.
Come be my Savior, Lord and friend.
As CBN partners, Ronnie and Jody are thrilled that their gifts to CBN help make Superbook possible.
Children around the world that may not ever hear the gospel any other way will see it through Superbook. It is such a blessing to be a part of that.
Change my life and make it new, and help me, Lord, to live for you.
I love Superbook, and just for parents out there who are watching, my children, I have two boys, 9 and 8, and a girl who's almost 4, and when the Superbook programs arrive in our mailbox, they are thrilled. They come in, they tear it open, Terry, and they put it in there before I can even do it. At first, it was me introducing them to Superbook and the Bible stories that CBN was producing in animated form, but now it's they gather me on the couch, and sometimes I'll be upstairs, and I'll hear them singing the Superbook theme. It's adorable, and they, in turn, after watching these Superbook episodes, ask me so many questions about the Bible and who Jesus is, and it engages conversation I don't even need to initiate.
They're moments. They're those moments that a parent waits for, that a grandparent waits for. And, you know, kids learn through rhythm and rhyme and repetition. And what a great opportunity to invest in their hearts with the Word of God. It's
and
awesome.
After my children have seen these Superbook episodes, I find them reminding me of God's promises.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a remarkable thing. So if you'd like to get on board, the current episode of Superbook is The Tower of Babel. If you join the Superbook DVD Club, you'll get a new one every 4 to 6 weeks. It's only $25 each time one is released to be in this continuity program, and you're the first in line to receive new episodes. You can go to CBN.com to join or call 888-777-1999. You can also go there to get past episodes as well. And our goal is to have 300 million people around the world see this show. It's a wonderful project. I highly recommend it. We leave you with these words from Psalm 97, verse 11. Light shines on the godly, and joy on those whose hearts are right. We hope you've enjoyed today's show. For Jessica and Terry, I'm Andrew Knox, and we'll see you next time on 700 Club Interactive. Bye-bye.